I found it.
Tell me what else you think it is that makes you suspicious that it might be him, then.
Thanks very much, studio. Can we stand by for transmission?
Years, 150 programmes, over 8 million participating viewers every month, 1,755 cases and 606 results.
And there's another string of cases that need your help. Faces and events that we hope you'll find familiar and quick results like countless ones in the past.
These men have one thing in common. With viewers' help, they were taken off the streets within 24 hours of a Crimewatch appeal.
Man, he's been charged with sexual assaults against children. He's Eric Stobart, balding, around 40, 5'10", but heavy set. He has a Tyneside Act. In 1995, a warrant was issued for the arrest of this man, Alexander George Fraser. He's 32, 5'10", and as you can see, has a scar on the middle of his face. And you won't want to befriend, it's David Christopher Goff. He has a habit of stealing friends' credit cards and documents. David Goff may use the name Matthew Hewitt.
Now, another face you might have seen, this is John Jenkins, though he uses other names, especially David's. He's medium height, going bald, and wears glasses. He has arthritis.
He calls himself Graham Morgan, but that may not be his name. He claims to be a painter and decorator, but is wanted in connection with several thefts and deceptions.
This man, Father Seamus Heatherton, he was the parish priest for Swanley in North Kent, but he disappeared and so has over £100,000 of church funds.
16 months later, at the Inner London Crown Court, John Baldock pleaded guilty to 139 offences of burglary and was sentenced to 7 years.
Murdered in her bedroom in East London. Detectives say this man, Stephen Hector, could be pretty dangerous at home.
And again, last month, within 24 hours of our programme, a man was arrested in connection with one of our main cases. You'll remember the enormous coverage our appeal got. There had been at least 12 sex attacks around London, Essex and Sussex. Detectives took over an anteroom here in the studio and they set up an operation to find the suspect. The leader of the joint inquiry is Commander Paddy Tompkins. It wasn't really Crimewatch viewers that solved this, in as much as it was almost solved. At least you got towards the arrest before we came on the air.
Well, there are a number of calls into police incident rooms as a response to the trailers from Crimewatch that were shown throughout the day. In response to the programme in the evening, over 600 calls. And I think, most importantly, Crimewatch gave three women who'd been the victims of sex attacks in the past, not connected with our inquiry, but gave them the confidence to come forward. They're now getting the police support they need.
Paddy, thank you very much indeed. This case has, of course, yet to be heard in court, but we'll update you when we can.
Tonight's first reconstruction is the story of a woman's remarkable heroism and humanity. For over a year, a man in East London has been preying on her, tormenting her, and on one occasion, actually kidnapping her. We're going to show you that abduction at length, not only because it contains so many clues, but we need to prick someone's conscience. Otherwise, this could all be dismissed as just one man's sad obsession. In fact, it's a crime of our times, a stalker.
Yeah, thanks. Bye.
He'll be here in a minute. I'll give him a hand with his school books when I get back, all right?
I felt bad because he'd stopped for a while. You didn't totally think, oh, he's gone. But you thought to yourself, maybe he's stopped now. He hasn't been around, he's given up.
Dinner's ready. Oh, and don't wash up. And don't let Danny talk you out of brushing his teeth. See you tonight, okay? Bye!
Alright? You're going the wrong way. I said you're going the wrong way. Let me
me go.
I just want to talk to you.
Please, let me go. Let me get out of here.
Don't worry, I'm only trying to talk to you.
All right, I'll talk. Just let me go.
Let me talk to you first.
Let me out of here.
I can't imagine how much I missed you.
No.
But you know they kept me away. I love you.
No.
You know that, don't you? I love you so much. I always have done. You're a very caring person. You care about people. I know you do. I could tell by the way you are in that pub you work in. The way you listen to people. The way you listen to me. Look, I'm just trying to talk to you. Don't cry. There's no need to cry. I just talk, please.
I don't want to talk to you. Just let me out of this car, will you? Just stop the car and let me out. Please.
I didn't mean to hit you. I don't want to hurt you.
Look, it's all right, okay? Just don't do it again.
Sorry. You know, I've loved you since the first time I saw you.
No, if you loved me, just take me home, will you? Just
if you realised how much I love you, then maybe you'd love me in return. Stay there.
I wanted to run, but he would get me before I even got out of the car. I thought that would make him even more angry, and then he would really do something bad. He would do something really bad to me. I thought he would. I saw the keys. When I looked at the keys, I just wish I could drive.
You're cold.
I'm scared.
Drink.
Oh, no. No. Please, just take me home.
You're not listening to me, are you? I'm trying to talk to you. Isn't that clear enough? I've got things I want to tell you, but you just don't want to hear, do you? What's wrong with you? I love you.
If you really loved me, you'd take me home.
Oh, take me home, take me home. It's all you want, isn't it? Yeah. Okay. I'll take you home. But we're going somewhere else first.
Anyone but yourself. There are so many people I care about. I love my mother, my nephew. I love my boyfriend.
Your boyfriend? I know your boyfriend. You can't love him. I'm better than him. I can take care of you. He's a monster. I'm an angel.
I didn't want to hurt him. I didn't mean for that to happen. I just wanted to get away. And I just didn't mean to hurt him.
And make sure you're safe. And ring the police. Ring the police, Mum. Mum! Mum! Are you alright, Mum? Mum! 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 Mum!
I'm used to being able to do what I want to do, but I can't do that anymore. I can't do anything I want to do. It's like it gets to the point where you think he's changed everything, because no matter where you are in the house, you're wondering, even if he hasn't come for a day or two or a week, you know it's coming around about the time that he is going to come again. And the longer he stays away, you just think, what is he going to do next? What is he going to do next?
Well, Richard Bradshaw, clearly this man is terrifying and torturing this poor woman. I mean, this was the most serious incident in a long line. I think the last one was only last week he was around her house. I mean, how can you explain that? How is she reacting to it all?
I feel very sad for this woman. He's absolutely torturing her. She's a prisoner in her own home. She's frightened to go out. She's given up her job. And she's absolutely petrified.
Yeah, I can only imagine what she's going through. What do you actually know about this man?
Well, we believe he may be local. He seems to have a knowledge of the area. We also believe that because of his unnatural obsession with this woman, that he may be generally distressed himself. He has spoken of death of the relation and a breakup of a relationship with a girlfriend. He also turns up at all hours. So maybe somebody that works in regular shifts.
No, he didn't turn up between early 98 and December 98. Is that significant, do you think?
Yes, it is. But for some reason, he's kept away for quite some time, so we need to know why.
Now, what does he look like?
He's white with a Mediterranean appearance, 6 foot, stocky. He's 26 to 30 years of age. He's got short, dark hair that's brushed back. And this, in the incident, we believe may well be singed. And he may have burn marks on his forehead and down the left side of his face, but we can't be sure about the burns.
No, well, that happened on the 4th of December, so if you saw anyone or know anyone in that state, then let us know. And also, the car he was driving may have had scorch marks on it.
That's right. The ceiling of the car may well have been scorched.
What more do we know about the car?
It's a large, dark blue car. We believe it's a Mercedes. And the dashboard itself, we believe, is customised across the top with a walnut effect.
Not necessarily a Mercedes, but possibly it could be something else.
That's right, we believe it may.
Now, was he a cab driver, do you think, or was that just a stunt?
We're keeping an open mind. We just don't know whether he was a cab driver or not, or was using that to get to it.
The woman that we saw make eye contact with the victim at one stage during that reconstruction, you haven't heard from her and you need to.
That's right. We need to hear from anybody who saw the car driving about on the evening of the 4th of December, particularly the woman in Deva Street, Bow. She's white, in her 50s. She had light or grey, shoulder-length wavy hair, and she was walking a brown dog.
Let's hope she knows who she is. Now, that man knows what he's done, and now so do you. If you harbour any suspicions, do call. So many clues and so much anguish. It's a free call to us live here in the studio. Please ring and get him stopped. Or are there local or their local numbers also for the inquiry team? 0500 600 600 here to the studio, or 0171 275 5731. That's 0171 275 5731.
One of the less welcome peace dividends in Northern Ireland is that the focus can now return to solving ordinary crime. This man with ginger hair is in the First Trust Bank near Donegal Square in Belfast. Three times in one day he showed false documents at banks, but eventually one cashier became suspicious and seized his passport. The trouble with forged passports is, of course, that they have a photo. And here he is. Early 30s, 6'1", with what's described as a baby face under all that ginger hair. He may be English, possibly with a Manchester accent. 0500 600 600 or 01232 700 534. That's Belfast 700 534.
And now to two images that might unravel an elaborate scam. A lot of people saw these ads for unusual registration numbers in a magazine. But the reason the numbers were so unusual is that most of them were made up. If you try to buy one, all sorts of details were conned from you and used for a series of deceptions. Great pains were taken to cover tracks, but detectives have taken even greater pains and come up with this. It's a man going into a bank in Willoughby near Hull. He's in his early 20s. Who is he? Look at that distinctive haircut. And another man, similar age, again in Hull. If you know either of these men, 0500 600 600, and if you want to call officers direct, it's 01482 597 624. That's Hull, 597 624.
Yeah, what's your name?
We all know about the Stephen Lawrence murder. The Metropolitan Police were grievously criticised for mishandling the case. There's another murder that's caused enormous concern in the black community and beyond. But now detectives are making immense efforts to make amends. Michael Mentzon was found in flames, stumbling along the North Circular in Edmonton, North London, exactly 2 years ago. He died in hospital 2 weeks later. The police thought at first that it was probably suicide.
But at his inquest, the coroner recorded unlawful killing and the case was passed to the Met's new racial and violent crime unit. Michael's brother and sister are here, along with the Deputy Assistant Commissioner John Grieve. Kwesi, I know that you were with your brother in hospital 2 weeks after the incident. He died 2 weeks later. You managed to get a bit of information from him. What did he tell you?
Michael was able to tell us that he had been on a bus and taken the underground in Edmonton that night, and he may have been followed by three or four white youths, and that he was attacked by these youths near some phone boxes by Sweetbriar Walk.
Did he explain how he was attacked? What happened?
He said that Michael was a very, very quiet and peaceful and family-centered man, and he said he didn't approach them, he didn't say anything to them. They had attacked him totally unprovoked.
What else did he tell you?
He asked me, why did they do this to him?
So you say he was a very quiet man. Was he a loner?
He was just quiet, and he was happy to be with his family and his friends.
So it was an unprovoked attack, then?
It was totally unprovoked, yes.
John Grieve, in fact, you've had an enormous amount of help from the public already on this, haven't you?
Yes, we've had a lot of information. But we've had a significant series of calls in the last few days in the pre-publicity for this programme.
Anything important? I mean, do you think you've got any handle on who these people are?
We think that the people who, the people who did this, the people they're talking to, are watching this programme. They have been following the publicity. The people we're interested in are the people who are hearing the boasts of the people who attacked Michael, but they're also hearing some conscience-stricken people who were appalled by the events of the night in question.
Now, we're not reconstructing this case because so much is already in the public domain, and your advice is that most people who might phone us already know a fair bit. There'll be people who were on the W6 bus, which is probably the bus that Michael took from Southgate, arrived in Silver Street. There were apparently a lot of people around in Silver Street, even though it was 1 o'clock in the morning. They might have seen something. Your main target, of course, apart from them, is people who've heard rumours.
People have heard, well, more than rumours. We know people are talking about it. We know people have significantly talked about it in the last couple of days. We know the people that we're interested in are being spoken to by these criminals. We need those people to come forward. In particular, bits of the jigsaw puzzle are now beginning to come together. Things that were said much earlier in the inquiry now have much more significance for us. For instance, there's a couple of anonymous calls early on. We need that person to get back in touch with us. It fits in very significantly with the appeal that we're making tonight. So there were people innocently abroad that night around the phone box, but there were people who were involved in the crime and probably less involved and horrified by the turn events took place. No. This could have been a horrendous attempt at humour that went badly wrong.
You see, that's what I'm wondering. I'm wondering if one, two, or even three of these three or four people actually had never intended this should finish up with murder, but are still frightened about calling you tonight because of their involvement in what led up to it.
No, no, they should get in touch. The significant thing is here is that this family is not going to give up. We're not going to give up. Crime Watch has a fantastic track record of success, and I'm certainly not giving up on this one.
Can I just mention one thing which hasn't really been published up to now? You're pretty sure the accelerant was a can like this. This is probably something like WD-40. You're very keen too to find anybody who was, as a prank, spraying people with something like this, and indeed who sold this.
Yes.
2 years ago in the Northland.
And has had it sprayed to them. This wouldn't have been an isolated incident. Have you been sprayed with material and then wondered what that was all about, accompanied by horrendous racial abuse without realising that that was accelerant? Have you been threatened with a lighter? You know, this has got to be part of a series of events. Were you sprayed with this material on the night in question? Much more interestingly for me, if you've got a computerised till roll and you sell this sort of motor oil or other sorts of propellants, have you still got the till rolls? Have your accountants still got the till rolls? We'll be there to see you. Get in touch with us.
Not giving up on it.
I see. You've heard that the police say now they're not going to give up. 2 years on, how encouraged are you that something significant might come out of the result of the Crime Watch tonight?
Well, this is a very important time for our family. It is 2 years since Michael was attacked, burned and killed in this way. And we know that we are going to catch the people who did this to him. They're talking about it. So a lot more people know who those people are. Those people will be watching this programme, they'll be watching our appeals, they'll be watching the poster campaigns, they're wondering what to do, and they have to phone in. They have to give us all the information they know. There's a suggestion that perhaps one or more of the party weren't so involved. If they really were horrified, if they're making anonymous calls, they've got to follow it through. We are going to catch them, so they have to get in touch with us. They have to give us the information, because we're not going to stop until this is brought to closure.
Essie, Kwesi, thank you both very much for coming in tonight. Thank you.
Please, please don't hesitate. If you've got any suspicions at all, our number in the studio is 0500 600 600. The incident room is on 0171 230 4374. That's 0171 230 4374.
Just heard a recording of the voice. His name's Michael Sams. I used to be married to him.
Can you give me your name, please?
Susan Oak.
Every fear you've ever felt in your life, everything just hits you at once.
Have you got the money?
Who's this, please?
Never mind. Have you got the money?
He said, never mind, and that's when it hit me. I knew those two words, that was Mike. I was frightened for my children. Even when I was dialing the number, I was frightened for them. It's an awful thing to live with, that the dad has done all these dreadful things. But again, my children astound me. I'm just so proud of them because they've just coped so wonderfully, and together we faced everything, you know, all the publicity and to be in the media spotlight. I know that if I hadn't run Crime Watch, I would have always been known as Mike Sam's ex-wife, grudgingly. But now I'm known as Mike Sam's ex-wife. But I'm looked up to. I would say to somebody, don't hesitate in ringing in, because, say, if anything else happened and it was that person, you'd never forgive yourself. A young girl died in the midst of this, and I never, ever forget that. So I feel it's my duty to help as much as I can to compensate for Julie's death. Nothing can compensate for Julie's death. But if I can do my bit to encourage somebody else to ring in, then I will do.
Tonight, the big manhunt in South Wales for the serial attacker who turns on old people with indescribable savagery.
My name's Eric Williams, I'm a police officer. I'm working with the West Mercia Constabulary. In Worcester, I was actually a custody sergeant in the police station when Salter was arrested 2 or 3 years previously.
Just calm down and just listen to
you fat English bastard!
I phoned the incident room in South Wales. I gave them all of his personal details, told them that I thought that he would be a good suspect.
Yeah, he was drunk, acting suspiciously around that old folks complex.
He'd obviously previously been doing something of a similar nature in Worcester years before, but obviously not to the violent degree that he'd been doing it in South Wales. I do appreciate it must be much more difficult in some people's personal domestic circumstances where they feel they may have information about people they know and perhaps even their family and loved ones. But it is important that these people are caught and that we use as much information as we can.
Well, last month, 948 people like Susan Oak rang us with information. As a result, apart from the arrest and the multiple rape cases we told you, an escaped drugs trafficker was picked up, and the man found at Loch Lomond was identified.
Two men have been charged with murder and one with conspiracy to commit burglary in connection with John Nutter's death during a violent theft at his home. Another man has been convicted for robbery in Northamptonshire after a reconstruction we showed last February. And from last March, a horrible case in which three children were assaulted. A man has been convicted of rape and of endangering life. Five Crimewatch callers named the man, who was already known to the police.
Four other cases have also led to arrests independent of Crimewatch. Five arrests on the armed robbery in Staffordshire, one on the robberies in West London, one for drug dealing, and a man has been charged with the murder of the Norfolk schoolboy Thomas Marshall.
Who wants to be a quarter millionaire? Here's a cheque for £150,000 to be provided if you help secure the convictions of an armed gang. And here's another one for £100,000 if you can also recover what they stole. Why such a colossal reward? Well, security firms have had variable relationships with Crimewatch, sometimes keen, sometimes anxious to play down security breaches. But now a group of companies has joined together and said enough crime is enough. The trigger was the case you're about to see, the biggest ever cash robbery in Scotland. Eight weeks ago, in the oil capital of Britain, Aberdeen. 2 miles south of the harbour at Alton's industrial estate.
Basically, I thought they were up to something. A van parked at the side of the road that time of night, very quiet, all huddled up with dark clothing. He was about 5'8", wasn't a scruffy looking man. Put a moustache, came down over his lips.
Next afternoon, a Thursday, on the old coast road, 2 minutes from the estate, and a similar white van.
He wouldn't let me past. There was nothing I could do about it. I couldn't get past. He obviously didn't know where he was going. Slowing down, accelerating. He looked straight at me. No expression on his face whatsoever. He looked like Tosh from The Bill. Was very red complexion. He looked like he'd had a good night in the town. Unshaven, dark, very untidy hair.
Back on the industrial estate,
where a security company has a depot for its cash-in-transit vans.
The staff I've got are very loyal, and I'm probably the father figure, and we work as a family rather than as a business. You know, and we're going well together.
Well, look at this. We've got our first Christmas card.
Probably December, we get our first bloody Christmas card.
Sound of that.
Get it down on the floor! Hurry up, hurry up! Hurry up!
Shit.
It's a raid.
Open the bloody door!
Looked in the control room, all right, but the men are outside. These guys have got guns.
I could have kept the doors closed, but what could have happened? And I wouldn't have went any of my crew's death in my house. You get a horrible gut feeling. Somebody's been in, they've taken something of yours away. You know, it's like somebody coming in, turning over your house.
Nearby, rush hour traffic was building, coming out of the estate. Behind the white van was a white Vauxhall Senator. They turned onto the old coast road, heading south out of Aberdeen. 3 miles on is the village of Portlethen.
I was raging.
Yeah, I just wanted to go after the car and ask the guy what the hell he was doing. I just kept on following. He went towards Asta.
Meanwhile, another witness saw the white van arrive and head towards a remote car park.
When I went into Asta car park, I watched where he went. Well, I actually followed him and watched all his movements. He like dropped a guy off and who went into a dark blue car, and I thought there was something suspicious. Well, he had dark hair. He looked like an Arab guy, like a dark-skinned. He looked to me as though he was very suspicious.
Not far from Asda is Portlethen Church.
Is the Girls Brigade on tonight? Roll your window down. Is the Girls' Brigade on tonight?
Let's go.
He was mid to late 20s. I would have described him as being quite fat, quite clean looking. And there was nothing about the car that would have stuck out. Just a dead ordinary red Escort. You know, there's thousands of them you see every day.
Who was he waiting by the church? Maybe quite unconnected with the robbery. But an hour later...
You be a tell, there are two vehicles on fire. A Vauxhall Senator and a Bedford minivan. Over.
Peter Simpson, in fact, you had a huge pub response on this before the reward was announced.
Yeah, it's one of the biggest responses I've ever known in an inquiry like this. In the first 7 days, we were really inundated with information.
So you know a great deal about how to track where the gang were. Of course, now you need to find out who they are. Your concentration on this huge reward is presumably because you want to detach people who are relatively close to the gang.
Yeah, this reward, I think, is really intended for someone who is close to the gang, who has some intimate knowledge of the gang, and who can give us information which will lead to their arrest and conviction.
Now, how sure do you want them to be before they call? You're talking about people who've really just heard things on the grapevine, they're pretty sure they know who did it, or just people who look like any of these four or who might have had previous for this sort of thing?
We certainly would welcome any suggestions at all, but if anyone has specific information which would really assist us in this inquiry, then I can assure them that that would be treated with the strictest confidence.
Now, there's a local connection because the two vehicles were stolen in Aberdeen and stored there for a couple of weeks, but there's an English connection as well. One of the guys seemed to have an English accent. They stole largely Scottish currencies. It's going to be pretty hard for them to get rid of that. That's large sums, largely Royal Bank of Scotland.
Yeah, the vast majority of the money stolen was in Royal Bank of Scotland, 10 and 20 pound notes. And again, I'm hoping the reward will stir someone to give us a call into the incident room or the studio here.
Pretty nerve-wracking to do that. These guys threaten to kill people. They're going around with guns. People are going to be frightened about their names getting out to the gang.
Well, as I say, there's been no, I've personally no knowledge of any breach of confidentiality with information north of the border, and I can certainly assure the viewers that it won't happen in this case.
Well, up to £250,000, the person or the people who can solve this, and there's no premium line phone numbers here, it's a free call, 0500 600 600, and more officers are standing by in Aberdeen, that's 01224 386868, that's Aberdeen, 386868.
The attack itself was very, very violent. It happened in Birkenhead town centre at about 1 a.m. See if you know who this gunman is. He's in his 20s, about 5'8", thin, and a...
Operation Tornado, a whirlwind of police activity to stop a one-man crime. This man got more than he bargained for. He was found rifling through the house in Peckham. Someone else in the house grabbed a pogo stick and beat the burglar on the head. Here he is, leaving hospital after treatment. Do you recognise him?
We found out afterwards he'd been smoking crack cocaine in our bedroom. The thing I found most chilling was I felt if I hadn't been surrounded by people who were going to help me, that it all could have been much, much nastier. What actually happened because of Crimewatch is that he was detected and was actually stopped in the street much sooner than anybody had anticipated. And this, I really feel, is the value of the programme. Other families or individuals have been spared the kind of trauma my family went through because of this.
Now a face caught by hospital security cameras. Do you know who he is? 2 months ago, a man punched a woman and stole her handbag in Hampstead, North London. But he was seen by passers-by who chased him in their car. When they trapped him in the driveway, the suspect suddenly collapsed. An ambulance was called and he was taken to hospital, but disappeared before he was seen by a doctor. I doubt if he knew he was being filmed when he was wheeled in for treatment. If you know who this is, please let us know. He's 6'3" and around 19. 0500 600 600. Or you can call the local police on 0181 733 6659. That's 0181 733 6659.
I have another good video, a remarkable domestic one, and a surprisingly audacious crime. This is King Standing, Birmingham, and this man with the unusual walk is making sure nobody's at home. In a moment, you'll see his accomplice arrive and double-check. They're both about 20, medium height and build, and very recognisable. Now watch what happens next. The blue transit van is an R-Reg with black bull bars. The caravan is a green and white Abbey 215 GT, and its windows are etched with the numbers 61518. If you've seen the caravan, sold it or bought it, or you can tell us who the thieves are, either call us here on 0500 600 600 or try the police station at King Standing, 0121 354 1111. That's Birmingham 354 1111.
Well, I'm pleased to say that you're answering our pleas, you're calling in with information. We've had 78 calls so far on the stalker in East London. Six names have been put forward and a police constable has also rung in with some interesting information. But I know there's a lot of excitement over here. Deputy Assistant Commissioner John Grieve. John, tell me, you've yourself taken some interesting calls on your case, haven't you?
Yeah, I've taken some calls about race hate crime, about people who have been spraying people accompanied by verbal abuse. But we've also taken two really good calls on the murder itself about people people will become very interested in what we're actioning at the moment.
Well, let's hope you have even more news for us in the update. Thank you.
Thank you for your help.
After last month's appeal, this man was identified as Vincent Smith, a 31-year-old from Northumberland.
It's not possible to make an exact portrait. What we're trying to do is to produce a face which is going to be very similar to the kind of face that individual had when they were alive.
The day after our programme, a viewer rang Crime Stoppers and identified the victim. He was Harjit Singh, a 40-year-old Punjabi from Essex.
Well, not only has Harjit Singh been identified, but his killer has now been convicted. This man, too, was murdered, and gruesomely, his body had been cut into pieces. Well, here is a clay model built up from the skull, discovered with other body parts 6 weeks ago on the foreshore of the Thames, River Thames at Deptford. Well, DCI Brian Bowden-Brown is trying to find out who he was and who committed the murder. You say that it's one of the most gruesome you've ever come across.
That's true. It is one of the most gruesome, and it's certainly one of the most difficult. What makes it even worse about how this man was killed is he was disarticulated through the limbs, and whoever did this certainly had a degree of skill, and it would suggest that they're possibly a butcher, a mortician, and again they would have had the necessary sharp knives available to them to do it. He was also killed in a violent way. He was struck with a weapon, a violent blow to the side of the head, and then he was manually strangled.
Doesn't bear thinking about. What do you actually know about the victim, if anything?
Well, we believe that he was aged about 34, give or take a few years either side. He's about 5'7", of stocky build. We strongly believe that he's of Mediterranean origin. He's got dark brown eyes, dark body hair. Probably the most noticeable thing about him would have been his teeth. He had a nice set of teeth. Having said that, two of his teeth actually decayed in his mouth. Now that would suggest that somebody not very keen on going to the dentist.
And would have been complaining about toothache probably.
And would have had a lot of problems, that's quite right. But he also had very smooth hands, nice fingernails. Again, that suggests that he wasn't a manual worker. And his shoe size was 8.5 to 9.
Now, to your knowledge, a man answering this sort of description hasn't been or wasn't reported missing. So what does that suggest about his possible lifestyle?
It suggests that possibly he was a man who hadn't been in this country for very long, or he was a man who moved around, had no fixed abode. And that is why his family and his friends haven't yet reported him missing to us.
So where exactly were those remains found?
They were found by St George's Stairs, which is near the Pepys Estate in Deptford, South East London. It was on Monday, the 14th of December, at about 3 p.m. in the afternoon. A member of the public saw the remains and phoned police.
And you're convinced that the victim was murdered within 24 hours of being found?
That's right.
So you want to hear from anyone who was in that area 12th, 13th, 14th of December?
That's right. Yes, I do.
Now, you have sightings of two vans and subsequently the people attached to them that you'd like to trace?
That's right. There was a blue Volkswagen-type van that was seen about 8 o'clock on the 14th of December. Three men there. One of the men was wearing a red Nike jumper. The other man was wearing a faded green bomber jacket. A little bit later on in that same morning, a white transit-type van, two men that were interested there. One of them is wearing a three-quarter length, dark blue quilted coat, and the other man, very distinctively, is wearing a yellow fluorescent jacket without sleeves.
Okay.
I need to trace and eliminate those men.
Absolutely. Well, thank you very much for coming in. We've managed it twice before, reconstructing heads. We've solved those. Maybe we can make it three. Let's hope we can. If you've had any idea who he was or how he came to such a gruesome end, please call 0500 600 600 or the murder inquiry at 0181 853 1212. That's 0181 853 1212.
Think back to the school holidays, August last year, and this is Ruislip Manor tube station in West London. A group of youth started bullying a young man, and it quickly descended into mob violence. These two, the ones inflicting the most savage damage, haven't been identified. This one's in his teens, 5'9", with centre-parted brown hair, and the other one is about 5'2". They're good pictures. Who are they? These are the numbers, 0500 600 600, or British Transport Police Direct on 0171 387 0354. That's 0171 387 0354.
And I have an unusually good picture of a con man. Here he is in a banking workshop in Nottinghamshire. A man's wallet had been rifled in a building nearby, and this man got away with a large amount of money using a stolen switch card. He's late 20s, slim, 5'10", and some people think he may have pockmarked skin, others that he has a Mediterranean look. But if you know better, please tell us. 0500 600 600 or call the incident room on 01636 657 999. That's Newark 657 999.
Next, a serial rapist. Now, we're always at pains to stress how rare these strange rapes really are. What's more, new police techniques show that even when there are several attacks, they're sometimes the work of a single offender. And that seems to be true for our next reconstruction. A catalogue of crimes, but it seems by one man, which has led to a big inquiry called Operation Fairway.
Two and a half years ago, in Weddington, in Nuneaton, 11 o'clock on a Monday night, and a 15-year-old was heading home from a night out. Sensing someone was hiding in the bushes, she made a run for it. But the man stayed hidden by the only path into the estate until another girl came by.
I won't hurt you.
Where are we going?
Up here.
He was very nervous. He was shaking, which scared me the most, really, because I didn't really know what he was capable of doing.
Why me?
Because I like you.
He was wearing unusual white fingerless gloves. He had a cream-handled knife and a sleep mask of the sort they give away in aeroplanes.
He's taken my innocence away, really. I feel as though I haven't got much confidence in myself anymore.
He seems to know his way around the local alleyways and footpaths in Nuneaton. But in 1997, his attack scene moved to southern Birmingham. His hair was dark and in a bob, not graded, but cut like a pudding bowl down to his ears and parted in the middle. He had a watch, possibly an accurist, and its strap was metal. It was on his right wrist, not his left. His jacket was three-quarter length and had a bright and shiny lining. No women have reported rapes by him between early 1997 and November that same year. But did you encounter him? By the time we know he reappeared, he'd grown substantially in confidence, and this time he attacked someone on her own doorstep. By now, he had a balaclava, and he'd come well-equipped for his attack with a bag out of which he brought a torch and sticky tape.
I'd like to marry a girl like you.
He might be local, but his accent sometimes sounded Irish, maybe genuine or maybe put on to mislead. But his remorse seemed to be real.
I can't leave you here like this. I'm so sorry for what I've done. Here's your purse and keys.
One month later, 2 miles away, another attack, and possibly the same offender.
Don't make a noise. I won't hurt you.
Look, there are houses around here. It's not safe.
His target, a single mum, refused to be dragged away, and eventually she managed to persuade the balaclava man to move to a well-lit area.
I just need someone to love me.
What do you want me to call you?
You can call me Ben.
She managed to keep him talking. He was softly spoken and claimed he was born in Dublin, but once again the Irish angle might be fake. At any rate, she talked him out of raping her. Then, 2 months later, another woman, another southern suburb of Birmingham, and another escape. This time the woman's hands were bound and her eyes were covered, but she still managed to struggle free.
Oh, you put up a good fight. I'll let you go. Here's your things.
Now, back in Nuneaton.
Did you have a good night, love?
I was walking under the bridge by where I live, and then someone come behind me, and then just kept on talking, and I just wanted to get home.
Oi, come back!
And I got home, and he was still standing outside.
He obviously planned to attack my daughter. And if it wasn't that night, it would be another night.
Three weeks later, just down the road from that house, and a visitor detectives are hoping to eliminate. May last year, in the Graziers Arms in Weddington.
Double McAndrews, please.
Could this have been you?
I tend to remember faces fairly well, and for some reason he's stuck in my mind. The man's about 5'8". Has dark brown hair, dark eyes, was dressed casually with a black bomber jacket and a t-shirt.
He may have been in the pub before, perhaps with a dark-haired girl, but tonight he was alone, except for a black bag.
First thing I heard was footsteps behind me. Running, footsteps. At first I just thought it was someone I knew messing about. But then I realised it wasn't.
Put your hands behind your back.
This time he had cord, like from a washing line. He had a blanket, and the attack went on for longer than any had before. He's becoming used to this.
These hands just kept on getting tighter and tighter around my mouth. Thought we were going to die.
I'm sorry it had to be done. Just don't tell anyone. Say it.
I won't tell anyone. He must have been watching me. And if he's still out there, he obviously knows who I am. I'm just sick of being so scared.
Peter Furness, your best bet now, of course, is somebody who knows him intimately and recognises something in this pattern of behaviour. Now, it's going to be his mum, his girlfriend, something like that. What are they going to recognise?
This man knows Nuneaton very, very well. He probably either lives there now or has done in the past. He also has similar connections, we think, with the south of Birmingham. He's out late in the evening, early hours of the morning, sometimes carrying a bag. It's not just on the nights of the attacks. He knows where some of these girls live. He must have been stalking them or prowling in the areas of their homes before those dates.
Now he's taken to tying them up. That could be just to restrain them. It could be a sort of fetish that he's used in a private personal relationship.
Yes, he's tied these girls up by tying their hands behind their backs. He's blindfolded them. It's possible that he's done the same things perhaps with a partner or a girlfriend at other times.
One of them got a look at him and she saw that he had quite distinctive sideburns.
On the last attack, just 6 months ago, he had long sideburns right down to the jawline.
And he also had a logo on one of the jackets, which was very distinctive.
Yes, on one of the attacks, he was wearing a black jacket with red marks on the shoulders, and there was red embroidery, ISI, in capitals, on the left side of the jacket. And also on that jacket was like paint splashes along the front near the zip.
Okay, well, if there's any way that you can help, please, try the number now if you have any suspicion. This is your chance to make a difference here. 0500 600 600, that comes straight through to us. Or you can call the incident room direct on 0121 200 2552. That's the Birmingham number, 200 2552.
Now, I was on my way to work when I was abducted by my attacker. And what
ensued was a sexual attack, after which he tried to kill me. He tried strangling me with a cheese wire and slitting my throat with a knife and a broken bottle and leaving me unconscious, locked in a burning room.
Doctors say she's lucky to be alive.
My attacker actually watched the Crime Watch programme, and in feeling that he'd seen himself in the artist's impression, he actually took an overdose and did say to his girlfriend, "I think I've seen myself on TV." This ended up being very crucial to my investigation. I think that I've been very lucky to disassociate what happened by my attacker to him being a person. And I don't truly have any feelings about him. I felt very lucky to be alive and realised the power of the experiences I'd been through and how it could really help so many other people. If it's something that has devastated your life, you can find help within the victim support system and certainly within the new victim support line scheme. I feel that I have a very full life to live, and I'm not going to allow my attacker to do any more harm than he did on that day. The whole attack took only 45 minutes, but it certainly was 45 minutes that changed my life completely.
My sister and her husband were murdered in 1993, and it's just sheer horror. You can't believe anybody that you would know would be shot, let alone two members of your own family. The police came to us and said that they were going to involve Crime Watch and put an appeal together. I felt quite excited because I felt that there was going to be a really good result.
Good evening. Tonight we start with the callous murder of Nicola and Harry Fuller.
I would appeal to anybody who may be sitting there thinking, "I know that voice."
I popped over last night to see you.
On the Monday we were told it was Stephen Young. It was actually somebody that I knew and somebody that I used to speak to on the phone regarding insurance. People say that love is the most passionate emotion, but I believe that hatred is the most passionate emotion. And I hate with a passion Stephen Young. Since Nicky died, I've changed and my parents have changed. And I not only grieve for Nicky, I grieve for the life that I used to have. Anybody that has information about a crime should always phone, because you don't have to give your name, you don't have to give where you're calling from. They won't trace the calls, and it can make the difference to a family and friends of a murder victim. I'd like to thank everybody that phoned Crime Watch. Even the slightest thing can help, and it did help.
And please do help tonight. Our lines are open in the studio until midnight, and you'll see other numbers in a moment. They're also listed on CFAX on page 621, and you can email us at crimewatchuk@thebbc. If you've information on any crime, try Crime Stoppers anonymously on 0800 555 111. And if you're a victim of a crime, then support line numbers are also listed on CFAX page 621.
Join us on Crime Watch Update at 5 to midnight. And make a note of next month's Crime Watch, Tuesday, February the 23rd. Meanwhile, as we said in our very first programme 15 years ago, don't have nightmares. Do sleep well. Good night.
Good night.